Welcome. We're so glad you are here to worship with us today. May you find God speaking to you through this worship service today, and may your heart be filled with the joy of the Lord's presence. So let us praise together and sing. Please join me as we profess what we believe. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and of life everlasting. Amen. As we come to our morning offering, thank all of you who have been so faithful. It's because of people like you that the ministries of this church will continue. As a reminder, there are three ways that you can give to the ministries of this church. Of course, you can send a check to St. Matthew United Methodist Church at 300 North Air Depot, Midwest City, 73110. You can sign up for direct deposit, which you can find the form at www.stmatthew.org. You can fill that out and you can send it to us. On that same page, you'll also find a way that you can give online, and you can just take care of that there. Just know that what you give is used to touch the lives of many people in this area and around the world. Let us pray. Precious Lord, all we have comes from you. And we pray that what we give will be a blessing to others because of your generosity to us. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
When the stars came crashing down, tiny pieces to the ground, I was all alone down here, trapped beneath the atmosphere. Then I thought somebody called my name, spun around and caught a flame, gave into a God I didn't know. And now everything is falling into place. A brand new life is calling and I owe it all to grace. So much brighter living in your world, save you what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. I'm learning to be the light. When a heart is cold as ice, you can't melt it with advice. No one wants to listen to a list of things they shouldn't do. So I build a city on a hill, light a candle on the sill, knowing you'll be always knocking at the door. Oh God, I just want to love on everyone. All I have is yours to give, so let the people come. So much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. Something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, learning to be the light. Learning to be the light. I'm learning to be the light that makes the shadows hide. Light that breaks the curse of pride. Light that takes the weary when it's on. When it comes and crashing down, there's only darkness around. But in the distance I could see a flame. So much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. Gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, learning to be the light. To be the light. I'm learning to be the light. I'm learning to be the light. I'm learning to be the
Good morning. Gail Tatum coming to you from the safety of my living room on this beautiful Sunday morning. I miss seeing all of your faces. It's hard being distanced. As with many of you, I'm sure, nighttime is the hardest The other night, I woke up absolutely terrified. There are so many circumstances: staying healthy, financial insecurity, being isolated from friends and family. As I lay there trying to calm myself, the words to a song from The Sound of Music came to mind. When you walk through the storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a golden sky and the sweet, silvery song of the lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams are tossed and blown. Walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone. Stay strong, stay safe, my friends. We will be together again. This will end. Love you all. Bye.
We come to our time of joys and concerns, and of course, I miss you guys, as I have for weeks now, and it will be such a blessing when we come back together, and the good news, you're talking about letting us do that before long, but we want to make sure we do that with caution. Today is the 25th anniversary of the Alfred P. Murrell building bombing. We remember the lives that were lost and the devastation to our community and to our country. We honor the lost and those who stepped up in response to this tragedy. Father God, we, in this time of unknown, we give you thanks for our constant provision. Just as in those days following the Murrell building disaster, we pray for your hand of healing and mercy. We remember them and the sacrifices that they made, and their heroism and their courage. And we remember the history so that we will not repeat it. We lift up those who are suffering from this virus and complications because of it. We also lift up those who have been put on hold, some of the procedures and doctor visits, and we just pray that your mighty hand will continue to be upon them. We give you thanks for those working on the front lines of this pandemic and those supporting them in the background, and all the people who, for the safety of others, have given up and foregone a paycheck. Father, we ask that you would give them strength and that you would restore to them in the days to come tenfold that which they have given up. We pray for the safety of our medical workers, our first responders, for our firefighters, our police officers, and all of our military. And Father, give us strength to stay the course. It's in your precious Son's name, Jesus Christ, we ask and we pray. Amen. We come to our time of children's moment, and I know that a lot of the kids out there, you guys are feeling a little cooped up, a little sad, maybe even a little bit troubled. Listen to this scripture. It's from Isaiah. Why am I so sad? Why am I so troubled? I will put my hope in God. And once again, I will praise Him, my Savior and my God. Do you ever have a struggle with doubt? Do you doubt you're ever going to get to go out and play like you used to, or get to go see your friends and that kind of stuff? You know, if you're really honest, we all have some doubts from time to time. Doubt affects the lives of many believers. The reality is that no one of faith is ever perfect in this life. That includes you and it includes me. And if your faith is not perfect, then it can grow and become stronger today than it was yesterday. I like to think of doubt as that gap between the current faith we have and the perfect future faith that we will someday have. Doubt can actually strengthen our belief in God. When all this stay-at-home stuff is over, I want you to stop and I want you to think about how much more you appreciate being out and being with friends, and just appreciate it more than, and all the things that have happened more than you have ever appreciated it before. You see, God, we ask that you would use this for us, that we might know you better. So pray with me. Dear God, remember you have to pray back to me. Dear God, use this time to help me appreciate what I have and all that you have given us. We love you, God. Amen. Today's scripture comes from John 20, beginning at verse 19. Listen for the word of God. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said that, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my fingers where the nails were, and place my hand into the side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and the doors were locked. Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. David McKenzie tells a great story about a rather unlikely speaker who came to a university sometime back. It was the stronghold of fundamentalism. And according to the story, the speaker told the young people, "You are naive. You cannot continue to take the Bible and apply literalism to it." For example, he said, take the Old Testament. The Hebrew for read and read is the same word. When it talks about Moses leading the people of Israel through the Red Sea with the Egyptian army in pursuit, it really means that it was the Reed Sea that was no great miracle. There were only about 2 inches of water in the Reed Sea. It was more like a marsh. And a wind came along and it blew the water aside and they were able to slip through. And then he told them that a student in the background jumped up and shouted, "Hallelujah! Another miracle! The speaker lost his composure and he asked, "What did you say?" The student said, "Hallelujah, another miracle. Just imagine, God drowned all those Egyptian soldiers in just 2 inches of water." Some people have difficulty dealing with the miraculous. Today I want to talk about a disciple who had a hard time accepting Christ's resurrection from the dead. We all know his name, Doubting Thomas. Actually, he was not known as Doubting Thomas by his friends. He was called Thomas the Twin. And he was not the skeptic that many have made him out to be. It was simply that he was not there with the others when the risen Lord appeared to them. This might be a good place to begin our thinking this morning. Note that Thomas was missing from the fellowship of faith, and thus doubt came more easily. That happens. People start missing only one Sunday or two at first, and then worship becomes the exception, not the rule. And finally, they are lost from the fellowship altogether. Like the proverbial ember removed from the fire, they cool, they lose their ardor, their zeal, their enthusiasm, and become very difficult to rekindle. That had not yet happened to Thomas. He was not yet lost. He was simply missing when the significant occasion happened in the life of the Christian community. After all, he was one of the 12 selected by Jesus to be his disciple. A good guess would be that Thomas' heavy heart was responsible for his absence. Some people in times of grief want to be alone. Maybe Thomas sought out his own family after the crucifixion. Maybe he felt he would find more comfort there than he would with the other disciples who were left. We would not blame him if this were a time of crisis. It was for all the disciples. They knew Jesus to be the Messiah. They were awaiting the establishment of his kingdom. Now, he was gone, crucified like a criminal. Still, Thomas was missing when Jesus made his first dramatic resurrection appearance to the disciples. Thus, he was still in his doubt and despair. It was a good warning to us. Group support is powerful. That's the secret of another organization that has helped a great many people and grown quite prosperous at the same time. It all started with a lady who weighed 214 pounds. She weighed that much even after a lifetime of fad dieting. Her name was Jean Nidich. It was in an obesity clinic she found the help that she needed. That help came in two ways. It came from a form of a special diet. It also came in the emotional support of a group in which she shared with others about her eating problems. Soon she was inviting her overweight friends over, and pretty soon they were inviting every week another friend of theirs, bringing them together to give them and to receive emotional support. That was the beginning of Weight Watchers International. And of course, we know the rest is just history. Group support is a valuable resource. Group support is that's what the church is all about. One of the greatest of New Testament scholars, Dr. C.H. Dodd said that as the years came and went, he found a much greater need in the church to be comforted in the midst of life's sorrows and its sobs. D.T. Niles told of a member of his congregation whom he met on the street one day. She had been active once, but in recent months drifted away. She told Niles that after suffering numerous personal and family problems, God had become distant to her. She felt that she had lost contact with him. This was how Niles answered her. Not only now, but even in the future, there will always be times when God seems distant, when it looks as if God has forgotten and does not care, when prayers go unanswered and life is difficult, and at such times, you must learn to hold on to Christian fellowship. Now, that's a great word for us today in the midst of this pandemic. He continued saying, our difficulty, or your difficulty, is that you tried to hold on to God alone. And man was never intended to hold on to God alone. Maybe Thomas was trying to hold on to God alone. Whatever the reason, he was missing from the group when Jesus appeared to them. I've known people in the who have missed a special event in the life of the church, and they never are able to understand the significance of that event for others in the fellowship. It might be a choir cantata or a lectern service. It might be some regular Sunday service on a Sunday morning that somehow God uses in a very special way to touch hearts. But they weren't there. And it is very difficult to describe to them the wonder of it all. I appreciate so much those of you who take seriously your commitment to support the church with your attendance, not only for these events that are special and appealing to you, but every time the door is open, people who attend infrequently miss so much. Thomas was fortunate. He got a second chance. Some things only happen once. However, in the life of the church, if you miss them, you miss something very real, something very special. There is a second thing to be said about Thomas. Thomas wanted very much to believe. There are some people who are quick to tell you that they pride themselves on identifying with Thomas. I'm a skeptic. They say that proudly. I'm from Missouri. You'll have to show me. Actually, there are three approaches to doubt. One is the skeptic who says that he or she is a doubter and proud of it. That's a very convenient approach to life. In the name of skepticism, one can avoid making any kind of a commitment. The second approach is that of a person afraid to doubt at all. A voice inside your head suggests if you will if you doubt anything, you're going to fry in hell. If you entertain even the slightest doubt that everything that you have been taught is not true. This voice usually sounds very much like a person of authority over you in your life. The third group is made up of people like Thomas. And I suspect like you and me. This is the group of people who say, with the man who encountered Jesus, I believe. Help me in my unbelief. Mark 9:24. I read recently about some creative answers that come from a group of children in confirmation class in Birmingham, Alabama. Among them were some things they said, and here's just three of them. The natives of Macedonia did not believe Paul, so he got stoned. When people have only one wife or husband, they call that monotony. And finally, it's often difficult to hear in a church because of the agnostics are so terrible. And here we've been trying to fix the acoustics all this time, duh, right? Thomas was no agnostic. He knew that his Lord had been crucified. He knew that that had been pronounced dead, and he laid in a borrowed tomb. It was too much to ask him to believe that this same Lord was now alive and appearing to his disciples and friends. It would take more than their wishful assurances to heal Thomas's broken heart. Unless I see for myself the marks on his hands and place my fingers in his side, I will not believe. I mean, who among us would condemn him? Woody Allen once said, if God does exist, why doesn't he give me some sign like depositing $1 million in a Swiss bank account in my name? In spite of the humorous twist Woody gives on things, my guess is that Woody's question was a serious one. Why does God not give us just a little more evidence of his existence? Why doesn't he answer just a few more of our prayers? Why does he keep himself just a little beyond our reach? Dr. H. H. Farmer once wrote, if only God would, so to say, sign some of his gifts. If only, like the artist, he would put his signature at the foot of some masterpiece of coloring in the sky. Maybe you too have had that wish. If God would just sign his sunsets and his sunrises that I might know. So why doesn't God reveal himself to us in such a way that never again would we have to live in doubt or despair? Perhaps he hides himself on purpose. Perhaps in order to bring us to spiritual maturity, it is necessary for him to make faith a bit of a challenge for us. Consider prayer. What if he answered every prayer we prayed? Would we not be dependent upon him, become dependent children? And would not God be reduced to some mere servant, or at the very least, some indulgent father? We would develop an unhealthy relationship on him, rather than our ability that he has given us, our own initiative which he has given us, like a child who is never allowed to fail. We would never learn to walk. We would never learn to cope. We would never learn to conquer. We would never reach full maturity, full manhood, full womanhood in Christ. Besides, faith that comes too easy is not faith for the long haul of life. Even if we have our times of doubting, during times of stress, that does not mean that we are not seeking faith. We were made for fellowship with Him, and our hearts are never at rest until we find rest in Him. This brings us to the final thing that He said. If we seek Him, we will find Him. That's the promise of Scripture. He will not forever hide Himself from us. If we wish all your heart you truly seek me, if with all your heart you truly seek me, you shall surely find me. Jeremiah 29:13. Thus says God. Thomas did. 8 days later, he was in a room with the other disciples. The doors were shut, and yet Christ appeared to them. Peace be with you, he said. Then he turned to Thomas and he said, put your fingers here and see my hands. And put your hand here and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. There may be times in our lives when we will go through seasons of doubt and despair, feelings of spiritual defeat. Anyone whose Christian faith is worth anything will go through these kinds of times. His promises are sure, though. In our hour of need, He will find us. He will reveal Himself to us, and He will be there for us. It may be through a passage of Scripture. It may be through the encouragement of a friend or the singing of some favorite hymn. He will give solace, though. His mighty arm will never fail us. The late Corrie ten Boom told the story of how, as a child, she went to her father and she said, Papa, I don't think that I have the faith to handle real trouble. I don't know what I would do if you should die. I don't think I have the faith that some people have to face trouble. And Corrie's father looked at her tenderly and said, Corrie, dear, when your father says he will send you to the store tomorrow, does he give you the money today? No, he will give you the money when you are ready to go to the store. And if you are going on a train trip and need money for a ticket, does your father give you the money when you decide you may take the trip? No. He gives it to you when you're at the depot ready to buy your ticket. Corrie, God treats us the same way. He doesn't give you that faith until you need it. When you do need it, He will certainly give it to you. Corrie never forgot her father's words, and later her life became a testimony to their truth. There is no sin in doubting. It is within the will of God that we should struggle with our faith. You see, that's how we mature. Hear that. That is how we mature as we struggle through our faith. If we seek Him, though, He will always be there. We shall surely find Him. And in the meantime, let's cling together in His fellowship. trusting that when we really need Him, He will reveal Himself to us. He did this for Thomas, and He will do it for us as well. Thomas knew the Lord Jesus, and Jesus continued to work through him the rest of his life. If you would like to have a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ like Thomas, then ask Him into your heart today. When things become normal again, we can make arrangements to get you baptized. If you need to be baptized, just let us know. If you would like to become a member of this church, we would love to make that happen as well. Just again, let us know, and we will, as soon as possible, make that happen. Today, know that the Lord our God is working in our lives. He has not left us alone. If you are in need, let us know, and we will be glad to see if there's some way in our power that we might be able to help you. But know that God hears your prayers.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness.
And now may the one who is able to hold you up, may he bless you, may he keep you, may his face shine upon you, may he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then where'er you go. Precious name.